where we lifting up our holy hands and give you the glory, God. In the name of Jesus, God, we come tonight, God. Oh, God, come with the spirit of expectation. Whatever you want desire to be done in this place, God, we open to you, God. We open to your will, God. We have a yes in our belly. Oh, God, we thank you, God. Oh, God, for this privilege that you allowed us one more time to come in the house of one more time. Oh, God, not only praying, God, we praying for the nation, God. We praying for Shelby, God, in the name of Jesus. Where the enemy is rampaging up and down the highways and killing and destroying the souls of the people, God. We interceding for them right now. Even those that's on the outside, God. Even those that's sitting on the porch, God. We thank you, God. We thank you for you allowed us one more time to come in your house, oh Lord. We coming with a spirit to open up to you, God. Receive whatever you desire us to be, God. In times like this, God. Oh, God, every time we have a chance, every time you give us a bid to be in the house of God, we don't take it for granted, God. We want to be in the presence, in the safest place in the whole world, is to be in the will of God. We want to be in your will, God. Oh, God, in times like this, God, not only are we praying for ourselves, God, we even praying for those that isn't in the ark of safety, God, even don't have you on their mind, God. Oh, God, we give you honor and the glory, God. We thank you for allowing us to be, oh, God, in the house of God. We thank you allowing us to be in the kingdom, God. Oh, kingdom ministry tonight, God. Oh, God, to give you the honor and the praise tonight. We praying right now, God. Oh, God, have your mighty way, God. Oh, God, we thank you for salvation, God. We thank you for redeeming us from the penalty of sin, God. We thank you right now, God. Oh, God, we give you the praises from the fruit of our lips, God. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the saints. Your name is worthy to be praised. Oh, God, have your mighty way, God. Have your mighty way, God. Endow this woman of the apostles tonight, God. Let her down to the wells of wisdom, God. That she may speak to the nation, God. Speak to our hearts, God. Whatever you give to her to say, God. In a time like this now, God, we need to hear a word from you, God. We don't need to hear no entertainment. We don't need to hear no other thing but your word, God. Because David said the word that I hid in my heart, that I may not sin against thee, God. Oh, God, you said before heaven and earth shall pass the word, my word shall stand forever. Let us be in your word, God. Stand on your word, God, tonight. In the name of Jesus, God. And we come today, God. Oh, God, not complaining about nothing, God. Oh, God, because if you don't do nothing else, you don't done it all for us, God. Over 2,000 years ago, you said it was finished. Oh, God, and whatever we desire, oh, God, it's in your will, God, for us to have, God. If we delight ourselves, you will give us desires of the heart. If we submit our ways unto you, God. Oh, God, you said no good things that you will hold for them that walk upright, God. Oh, God. In the name of Jesus, God, we pray right now, God, for the family, God. In the name of Jesus, God. Oh, God, that the enemy is taking our family, taking it you. Oh, God, but we interceding right now, God. Oh, God, not only gold, those that is in high authority, God. We pray for our leaders, God. We pray for every leader, God. In the name of Jesus, every pastor, God. Every apostle, God. Every bishop, God. Everybody that is standing in the house of God. Proclaim your word, God. Give them a word in their belly, God. That they may speak to the people, God. Oh, God, and not compromise. In the name of Jesus, God. We cry out, God. We cry out tonight, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Help us right now, God. In times like this. Oh, God. We thank you, God. We thank you, God. We thank you for the Holy Ghost, God. That you allowed the power on this earth, God. In the land, and even now, God, we pray for the kingdom to come that was in us, God. Oh, God, in us, God. Oh, God, thank you, God. We give you the praise, God. We give you glory, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Oh, God, have your mighty way. Have your mighty way in this place tonight. We decrease it. That you may come forth, God. That you give us increase. We decrease, God. Oh, God. Let the people see nothing but you in us. Oh, God. Flesh got the back up. That the spirit come alive. In this place, God. In our life, God. Oh, God. Thank you, God. For reigning. You super reign in this house, God. You super reign in this nation, God. Oh, God. We thank you. We give you the glory. We give you the praise.
Struggling with drug addiction, with alcohol addiction, Lord. Deliver, deliver, deliver. Father, we know that there's nothing that you can't do. Deliver. Deliver that homeless person, God, from the streets. Deliver them in their mind, God. Deliver them in their hearts. We ask God that deliverance take place in the city hall, in the schools.
Such a peaceful, calm atmosphere.
We're definitely grateful to see each and every one of you. We're going to go ahead and get started. Before I start teaching, there is a prophetic word that I want to release. I typed it. Also, something that God gave me early in the day. And when I got home, he kept on dealing with me. So I figured, I said, hey, let me go ahead and share it with the people of God, to encourage you even the more. One of the things that I heard very, very strongly was that you do not have to explain where you're going. And God started dealing with me about explanation. How a lot of times we feel like we need to tell people how and why God has blessed us, as if we owe them something. And then he began to share, remember when you thought you didn't have? People thought that you didn't have. They never came and questioned or even come to your aid when you did. So if they didn't require an explanation when you did, they don't think that they deserve an explanation now. The Lord says, because of what he is doing, he said last week, he said change. There was going to be some changes in our lives. But this is the extension of the prophetic word. He says, for many, it is overdue support. And he began to remind me of, like child support. If you owe child support or have a back pay of child support, what they do is, whoever owes, whether it's the mom or the father or whoever, what they do is they still say, hey, this is the payment, and whether they take it from somebody's taxes, it doesn't even matter how they get it. But what they do is they go after that support that's due, and if they can give it all to the kid, if it's a good state with good government order, what they'll do is they would give it all to the kid because it's overdue. It's overdue. You've been supposed to have gotten support. And then, and I'm going somewhere with this, because he reminded me of an individual. He showed me a vision of an individual that I know who's in her 60s, or close to her 60s rather, and she is still getting child support for her children who's in her 40s. And I began to think on that. And God reminded me, and he was allowing me to see, that's what I'm getting ready to do for my people. See, because in the natural, it doesn't make sense. How could a 60-year-old woman be receiving child support and her children got their own family, they got their own kids? But if something is due to a person, it doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter that she's the age that she is. She still is entitled to something. And this is the word that the Lord wanted to release to you all. You are still entitled to something. It doesn't matter about what it looked like. It doesn't matter how long it took. He said, just let my people know that there is an over support that is due to you. In other words, the support was always there, but there's some more that's been due to you, regardless of why it was held up. It doesn't matter why. It doesn't matter if God held it up because of you. It doesn't matter that the enemy tried to mess with you and it was held up because of that situation. The thing that you need to know tonight and be excited about is that now he is releasing it. And this is why he said, let them know or remind them that when I said a change is coming, he meant just that, a change is coming. Some things have been overdue. The Lord says, you get ready to get it. He says, it's okay that there's a lump sum coming in. It's okay that all the seeds that you have sown are now coming in. It's okay if God is going to do something new in you. You do not have to explain the new change in your life. Just continue to be the salt in the earth. This is the reason why the growth, this is a season of growth and expansion. Many are not feeling comfortable where they are at in life, and it's the stretching that's making you feel uncomfortable. But be ready, because at any time, I am going to cause you to soar beyond your wildest desires. This is a season of sincere strategy and planning. Many of you have been asking questions such as, is this the one, or am I going the right direction? But I want you to know that I will never lead you astray. Take your desires and replace them with my desires, and you will see the truth in the whole matter, says the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I feel encouraged just off of that.
That's it.
Overdue. Look at somebody and say overdue.
Overdue.
Say overdue. You got some stuff that's overdue to you. I tell you, have something that's overdue to you. You got some stuff that's overdue to you. Did you bring what I need? Come on. Give it to me. I'm sorry y'all was in a hurry. I left my rings. I need my rings. Come on.
That's overdue.
That's overdue. You got that right. 16 years. Come on, bring my wedding rings. Thank you. Alpha Gal. This is why you do not have to explain anything to anybody. It's just overdue. You know, it's just overdue. All right? I'm excited for what God is doing in the lives of the people. All right, let's go ahead and get into the teaching. I just want to release that prophetic word. So on Sunday, thank you, I'll tell you this, God. So Sunday we spoke about know, the word know. It's one thing to know of someone, and it's another to really know someone. There's a difference. If I say that I know of a person, then I'm saying that I don't really have a whole lot of facts. I have just enough information to tell you what you want to know. But when I come into the place to where, or come in contact with someone that I have had fellowship with, then I can really say, I really know them. I know them on their good days. I know them on their bad days. If something were to happen, I wouldn't be surprised, or I wouldn't be thrown off, because I can really say, I know that person. That person wouldn't do that. I don't believe what they say. And see, remember I said on Sunday, see, when you really don't know people, what happens is, if you don't take the time to get to know a person, then what happens is you go off of what other people or their experience with them. And sometimes it's those bad experiences with other people that messes up our fellowship. It messes up what we could be doing on another level, because somebody else is still holding a grudge about something in the past. You know, like if we say, well, you know such and such? Like I said, son, you know such and such? Yeah, I know. Mm-hmm. I know. Why? What you want to know about? See, when people start talking like this, say, no, I'm not just asking. Just hold on to it. Because you don't want the seed being sown into you. And then what happens is now you become that individual who was the messenger, and now you stop liking somebody before you get a chance to know them. We see that, I don't know about y'all, but I see that a lot in churches, okay? We ain't gonna talk about it in the world, because the world don't have to like you. And I think you said it one time, Apostle, the world ain't gotta like you, but if the world wanna drink, they gonna still drink with you. They ain't gotta like you to party with you. They can be mad at you and be looking at you from one side of the wall, being on one side, look at y'all cock-eyed, but they ain't going nowhere. But when it comes to the church, I ain't going up in there. I know about them. Now you know. I know. They be speaking in tongues and all that. I ain't doing all that. Do you know what it means? Do you know what we really do? You see flags, you see the shofar, you see the Ark of the Covenant, do that scare you? Do having certain things in here, having the banners, or just having certain things, does that scare you? Do you really know what we're about? Do you really know what the individual's about? Do you know what the pastor is about? Before you start placing judgment on them, or even releasing judgment on them to somebody else. And this is why I said this messes up relationships, because many people could walk in freedom and their deliverance if they stop listening to other people. If they stop listening to other people about you and start and trust God with the Holy Ghost on the inside of them and say, God, show me whatever it is I need to know. Mm-hmm. And sometimes he can show you stuff, church, but it doesn't mean all the time, it doesn't mean that you go and just share everything with everybody. He could just be showing you so you know how to pray for that person. It doesn't mean that you have to release them totally from your life. People, you know, can I be honest? It's like we drop people from our lives like it's, you know, just like it ain't nothing. We don't have the love of God like we're supposed to. We don't do what God tells us to do. But the first time somebody do something, we go run and tell other people so they can get on board with us, so they can start knowing what we know about them, which then affects the kingdom of God. Because then guess what? It brings division. And any time a house is divided, what? It ain't going to stand. It's going to fall. Okay? So just like I'm using this illustration about knowing us. And when I talk about us, I'm not just saying me or the ministry. I'm just saying in general. But when we talk about learning or knowing us, I want you to look at how do you know God? How well do you know God? Do you know God based off of somebody else's association? Do you know God based off of your pastor's association? Meaning that the only way you know God is because when your leader get up here, you can say, oh, I can see God in her. I can see God in him. Well, do you see God in you? Do you know God enough to know that he can still work in you? Do you know him enough to know that it's not just this person who's anointed, but can you know him enough to realize that just because I ain't saying much doesn't mean that God ain't in me? It don't mean that he's not working through me. Okay? So you gotta know God. You gotta know God. The problem with knowing of God is that you don't get the rewards from the true fellowship of knowing him personally. We don't want to just know of God. I don't want you to just know of Kotanya. I want you to know me, okay? Give some examples of people who know of God. This is what they will say. They will say stuff like, I know he said something about resting on the seventh day. That's why I ain't going to church. I'm just going to chill. I ain't doing nothing. I ain't cooking. I ain't doing no laundry. Y'all can't make me do nothing because he said rest and I'm going to rest. Another person might say, I know he sent an angel and told Mary she's highly favored, but that's about all I know. Somebody else may say, I know who God is. He's a big man upstairs. Mm-hmm. You heard people say that? I won't be like Candy Jones. Some call pop, pop, can I do it? Some call John, can you do it? That's how she be looking at me all straight. Okay, I'm sorry, y'all, I don't want to embarrass y'all. But some people say that. Some people say he's just a bit, I pray to, or I talk to a big man upstairs. Okay? Some people might say, I know who God is. He got preachers on every corner. They supposed to live right, they're supposed to live holy. But all of them ain't nothing but a whole bunch of hypocrites. These same people are the people who say, I know what the word says. I can read for myself. They ain't nothing but hypocrites. The same people who know of God will say something like, I know who God is. I know my mama, she made us go to church every Sunday. I sat in the back. It didn't matter if I clubbed or not. She said, as long as you in church, that's all that matters. So I slept in the back. I know God. He know me. I was sitting in the back. Mm-hmm. Some people would say, I know who God is. My mama told me, anytime I get in trouble, pray. So that's what I do. I pray over my food, and I pray before I go to bed at night. So I know who God is. Some would also say, I know who God is. Because I got that job promotion, I thanked him. And I told my friend that it couldn't be nobody but, again, the big man upstairs. See, those type of statements that I just used are statements that people use. It is real. Those are people who know of him. They don't have a relationship with him. He's not the big man upstairs. He's not Pop-Pop, you know. Yes, he is Jehovah Jireh. Yes, he is G-O-D. Yes, he has all these other names. But you have to understand, when we say like Jehovah Rapha or Jehovah Jireh, we're not saying it just to let you know that we know the different names of God. But we're saying it because we understand his attributes can change at different times. And because I've been in a situation, a time or two, I've seen the healer step in, but yet I still know he's a provider. See, when you know God and not just know of him, then you know that God can do anything. He can do anything but fail. He can do anything but lie to you. When you know who God is, then you know that in the beginning was his word. And his word will continue to be found no matter what you go through. See, a person who knows of God can't find, it ain't that they can't find God, but they don't know where to look. And that's kind of like what we were saying earlier about how we used to know how people, when they would get in trouble, how people would run the church. Now people don't run the church when they're in trouble. They just, whatever. It is what it is. I'll just call it a loss. We'll see what tomorrow brings, if it brings anything. You know, they don't know where to turn. You know, back in the day, we was brought up, you better go to church. Not just because you need a seat in the pew, but you better go to church because you better get right with God. And if my grandma didn't say anything, that's what she was trying to instill within us, to get right with God, because she knew it was something about us, or it was something that the enemy was trying to do to make us to do the opposite of what God wanted us to do. See, when you know of him, then you only know him based off what someone else has said. But when you decide to be intimate with him, then that's when that relationship is established. That's when you begin to look at him with a different set of lenses. That's when you begin to say, hey, I can praise God anytime. It doesn't matter who's here, who's not here. It doesn't matter where I'm at. I have a reason to shout and give God the glory. Why? Because I know what he has done for me. When you know God, it doesn't matter what the music is playing. When God drops a nut in your spirit, you may be the only one jumping up and down, but only you know that you ain't nothing all week. But then God said, I'm getting ready to bless you real good. I'm getting ready to put food on the table. I'm getting ready to open up doors that no man can shut. See, when you got that kind of relationship, you don't mind running around the church. You don't mind hollering. You don't mind clapping while everybody looking at you all strange. See, folks who just know of him, they looking at you trying to get the association. I'm trying to figure out through you who he is and why you doing what you do. And if it doesn't make me move like it makes you move, then maybe we ain't serving the same God. See, I can use Octavia for example. Again, she just gonna chill. She just gonna look. She's not like me. She doesn't jump up and she don't do all that extra stuff. But it doesn't mean that she does not have a relationship with God. She's not just studying at me to know of him. She already knows him, whether she jump or not. You understand? So whether she do the way that I do, it doesn't matter. What matters is that she knows that, hey, when I feel him, I know I can respond. Mm-hmm. Even if there's a tear that comes down my eye, I don't say, oh, Jesus, don't let that one flow. No, I want to release it. Why? Because I know he's been that good to me. I know you may look at me like something's wrong, something's going on in my life. No, ain't nothing bad going on. The only thing it is that I just realize how God has been so good to me. I'm not just building this relationship off of association. I'm not just building it off of what other people have said. I'm not doing it. Why? It might be too late. You might be too late waiting to get it because of somebody else. But if you can get it for yourself, let's go to Philippians 3. To know him. Not know of him. Come on, tell somebody, don't know of him. Come on. Yeah, tell him. hear. Let me hear what the Spirit is saying into the church. See, sometimes God has to close your eyes to some stuff and lead you. And lead you with directions of other people. Because even in the book of Acts, the 9th chapter, the Bible says that the men who was with Paul, they heard, but they didn't see where the sound was coming from. And see, God has a way of doing things that doesn't get the attention fully of other people, and that's okay. This is why you don't have to explain to people what God is doing to you. Paul, all that he knew was this. I thought I was right up until now. And Paul was cool enough to admit that everything else that we've been doing is wrong. But now I know what's important. What's important is understanding the power of his resurrection. What's not important is wearing the cloth, wearing the robe, sitting at the table filled with leaders. Having my name written in the book of who's who. That's not important. It used to be important, but that's not important. Paul was saying what's important is that I understand the power, the experience that this man Jesus went through. If he can still speak to me after I have persecuted the people on my way to deal with something, if he can still call me out and stop me, then surely there's hope for you. And the next person. And this is why when we preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, we have to give it to the people straight. We have to give them truth. We can't sugarcoat. We can't play with people. We have to call it like it is and say, yes, even though you are in this situation, God still has a remedy to bring you out. Now, when he bring you out, it's now time for you to get a relationship with him so that he can do what? Keep you out. Okay? Paul says, this other stuff, it doesn't mean me any good. It doesn't do me any good to have all of this and lose him. He says to us, what he wants us to understand is that his experience with God at that point means everything. Have you ever been in church and it seemed like you were the only one who felt the presence of God? Whether or whether you shouted, or whether you had chills all over you. And you try, have you ever tried to explain to somebody else? Oh, and you say, look, I got chills. You want them to see that the presence, that you feel something, that there's something going on, and they look at you like, that ain't nothing. I don't have it. You know? See, your experience with God is not like mine. Whatever he does or decide to do to you, through you, whether it's in a service, at home, that's a personal experience. See, even though I see all of you here tonight, this is still a one-on-one situation. God is talking to you, we're doing a one-on-one dialogue. He's talking to you individually. And this is why stuff that you may have gone through earlier, the next person didn't know. But when you hear stuff like when God say, you ain't got to explain where I'm taking you, it does something to you because only you know that God is getting ready to bless me because he know what I just went through. I know what I just went through. And I know I've been thinking, how am I going to explain to them? How am I going to let them know where this money comes from? How am I going to let them know all the folks going to be calling me now? Everybody going to be wanting a piece of this and that. They don't realize that I live the life of sowing seeds. They don't realize I live the life consecrated to the Lord. They don't realize that I live the life unto the Father that was pleasing to him. And just all of a sudden, now he's saying there's some overdue stuff that's due to you. And I got to get in and say, oh, listen, God's trying to tell us right now, go ahead and get out of your system. You don't have to explain nothing to anybody on why he's doing what it is that he's doing. When God said, I'm sending a change, it ain't no different from him sending a change to Apostle Paul. He sent the change because he needed the people to see that I am going to do something new. This thing that you thought that I was doing, God said, I ain't doing it no more. I'll get ready to bless your socks off. Now that right there is just a phrase. Go back to it. Come on, look at somebody and say, you ain't got to explain to nobody. See, when you know God and you know God is faithful, Uncle Albert, you ain't got to explain to nobody why God blessing you. Come on, when you know God and you know God is a good God, you ain't got to explain to nobody why God opened up doors. They even looking at you talking about, well, how did you retire so early? Because God. Don't be like, well, you know, I served my time. I've been faithful. You ain't got to give nobody no explanation. The only one you need to be giving explanation to is to God. God, I thank you. What's my explanation? God, I'm going to keep on blessing you. Thank you for what you're doing. Thank you for what you're getting ready to do. Thank you for what you already said that you're going to do. Thank God if you don't do nothing else but just give me what's been overdue. You ain't got to give me nothing else. Just give me what's overdue, because whatever's overdue is going to satisfy my now and my later. That's why we get excited.
Yes, sir.
That's why we get excited when we say we get back pay child support. That's why we get excited when we know, well, we mature, so we know we don't live off of taxes. We understand, we mature, we don't live off of that. But for some people who wait on the time, they get excited because they know money's like getting ready to come, but it's going to overtake them. But I want to let somebody know, God is getting ready to do something that IRS cannot do for you. When you know, you celebrate.
Yes, sir.
In good times and in bad times.
Yes, sir.
When you know of him, you come to church after you get out of the car wreck. And you limp to the first seat in the back. When you know of him, you sit there and you just sit there. Well, brother so-and-so, God bless you. We heard you was in an accident. God bless you. Yeah, I figured I might want to come in here and just thank God, pay my dues, since the big man kept me from the accident. Yeah, it could have been worse, but yeah, I just got just a little broken leg. You know, it ain't nothing. But I wasn't using that much anyway. I wasn't working. I wasn't doing nothing. Sitting at home chilling. So it's okay. But I figured, you know, my wife was getting on me, and I figured I'd come on to the church and, you know, let the bishop pray for me, and you know, we're gonna see if I can, you know, while y'all pray, you know, y'all pray that this insurance money come in, you know, just a little bit quicker, you know, than what it normally would, you know, because I know y'all be saying that God will do it. So if God will do it, then ask him to do it just for me, you know, because I don't, you know, because I came in, you know, after my, you know, so. See, that's a person who know of him. But when you know him, you're coming in on them crutches. Honey, can you follow me for a second? I know I'm embarrassing y'all. Just follow me. When you know how you do a muscle, you come in on your crutches.
Yes, sir. Limp.
Give me something, Tay Tay. Just give me something. Come on, Tay. That's the actually. You coming in. How y'all doing? Praise God. He's good. Come on, we're going to testify. We're going to testify this morning. Pastor Bishop, come and testify. I just want to let everybody know how God has been good. Me and my wife was in an accident, and yeah, we didn't see that truck coming. That truck came in and it came in to hit us. But God is good. I know God is good. Come on now. They said I would have to wear these crutches, this cast on my leg, and have this crutch for 6 weeks. But I know God to be able. I know God can do it. I just need for the elders of the church to pray for me. Come on, the Bible's going to be sick among you. Let them come up for the elders and let them pray. Let them anoint you. I know some Holy Ghost feel. Don't y'all know? What y'all think? No. treat God. That's not how to treat God. We don't just bless God when things go good. We don't just, no. See, when you know God, I thank you. I thank you in good times, I thank you in bad times. I thank you, God, because you are amazing, God. I thank you, God, because I know that I can call on your name at any time and you will come through. God, it may not be your time for this thing to take place, but God, allow me to be patient, God. God, not my will, but let your will be done, God. Father, I believe who you are, and you are an amazing God. See, a person who knows God can tell who he is, and you never know, you just keep reminding God who he is. He might just change his mind about the whole situation and say, okay, God, I see you. Okay, son, I see how you still praising me no matter what you're going through. I see how you still loving me no matter what you're going through. I see how you still sowing your seed and you're giving an offer no matter what you're going through. See, but a person who knows of him, I ain't doing nothing. God understands. He understands. He don't expect me to give my all. See, a person who don't love him say words like that. He don't expect me to give my all. You ain't read the word. Because if you knew God, then you know he gave his all. He's not going to expect you to do anything that he wouldn't do. He's not going to expect you to give up anything that he can't give back to you. He gave his only son, Jesus. Gave him up. But he gave him back. The Apostle Paul says to know him, to know the power of his resurrection. In other words, I know and I see for myself. They thought that they had him. They thought that they had counted him out. But on the third day, they thought it was over when it pierced him in the side. They thought it was over when they put the crown on top of his head. When they turned their backs on him and they said that he can't be. They thought it was over. But still the glory of the Father had enough power to raise him from the dead. What am I saying tonight? When you really know who God is and not know of God, then you know that it's God's mighty hands the way and allowed the son to come forth, and he who took away had the same power to give him back to us. And if God can do it for a man named Jesus, then surely he can do it for you. Surely he can give you whatever it is that you may have lost. Surely he can give you anything when you call on the name of the Lord and be like who God wants you to be. God, I want to know you and the power of your resurrection. I want to understand your suffering. I understand that in your time of suffering, it did not make you stop. In your time of suffering, it gave you more power. It gave you more it gave you more energy to bounce back from the dead. That's what the Apostle Paul was talking about. Being persecuted. Jesus told him back in Acts, he said, listen, man, you're going to go through for my name's sake.
Yeah.
So the transition from Acts to Philippians, the Apostle Paul had experienced some stuff. And got to the point and said, oh my, all the stuff I thought I knew, it ain't got nothing on what I know right now. I'd have been bit by a snake, but it didn't kill me. I'd have been shipwrecked, but I held on for dear life. They came after me to persecute me, but I still have my saying. See, you gotta stay in church. When you know God, that it doesn't matter about what the enemy wanna do to you. That's why you hold on to the plans of God. And you say, God, no matter what I face, I still believe Jeremiah 29:11. You know the plans that you have for me. Your thoughts toward me are good thoughts. To do me good. No. To give me a hope. To give an expected end. That's what he wants. When you know God, you understand that. When you know God, you're not sitting at home pity party. You're not sitting at home rocking back and forth. I don't know how to get out of this. I don't know. No. When you know God, you may not see how, but this is why you gotta walk by supernaturally how this is going to get done. In my natural mind, I don't see it being possible. But who am I anyway, God? Because I know you, I've seen the things that you've done. You said in the beginning was your word, and your word is still found today. So God, if Jesus can raise the basket up and bless it and still be able to feed a multitude of people, then surely you can take care of this situation. Why? Because I know that. My association is not just through the pastor on Sundays or Tuesdays or Wednesdays. My association or my knowledge of who you is because when I'm driving down the road, instead of listening to the radio, I'm Ekrasa Bo Shikarasi Bashata. Instead of me calling somebody and saying, hey, what you doing? I'm up there speaking in my heavenly language. Instead of being on the phone talking, instead of texting somebody, I'm saying, Lord, you're so good. Look at the sky, God. Look at what you're doing, God. I see the sky. I see the stars, God. I see the sun. I see everything that you said let it be, and it still is, even to this day. So, God, if you're able to keep the sun in its position, then surely you can keep the devil off my back. See, that's what a person say when they know him. But when they don't know him, stress. Scratch. Because you're nervous. For real. Because you're nervous. When you don't know, you're back in the corner somewhere, sucking your thumb, trying to figure out life. When you know of him, I'm sorry, when you know of him, you're in the corner sucking your thumb. But when you know him, come to church. While everybody walk, look at it. What's wrong? I tell you, still ain't giving me no beat, but it's okay. You come in and shout. You come in and talk about thank you, Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Ain't nobody started service yet, but you walk in the church.
Yeah.
You're walking back and forth. Talking about God, thank you. You didn't have to do it, but you done it. You begin to think about how far he has brought you. See, when you know God, you ain't what you know God. Woo. When you know God, you know that you got that responsibility to every now and then reflect back and see how far he has brought you. And think of the goodness of Jesus and all he has done for you. This is why sometimes it's okay that your soul cries out. Hallelujah. Let them look at you strange. Let them look at you. Let them record you. But still, hallelujah. Bring out the handkerchief. Bring out the sheets. It don't matter. Bring them out. Because I know how good God has been. And if I got to bring a hill or two every Sunday, then I'm going to bring them. Because I know, I've had relationship, I've had observation, good God Almighty, I've had observation that God has not failed me yet. I have observation, I've seen him heal people from diseases, I've seen him bring people from the bottom and raise them to the top. I've observed stuff like this. I've observed God to take one messy situation and turn it around. See, when you say I can see, I've seen stuff like that, that makes you a candidate to praise him. But when you know of him, you sit in the back. What they had before. What they doing that jumping for. What they doing all that for. Ain't nobody entertaining nobody. You don't know what it took for me to get here. You understand? You don't know what it took for me to be holy. You don't understand what it took for me to have God, to tell God daily, God, renew my mind. Help me to stay focused. towards the cross. Each and every one of us have a prize. Each and every one of us have a race that we gotta run. Each and every one of us has something individually and corporately, especially if we're married, that we have to go through. But at the end of the day, the same God who deals with us individually is the same God who deals with us corporately. And because of pure observation, we have never seen the Lord fail us, that we can continue to shout from the mountaintop that He is worthy to be praised. Don't let your situation put a mute on your mouth, but continue to tell God, God, I thank you. You are worthy to be praised. Even when your back is up against the wall, you may be up against the wall, but it doesn't have to stop your praise. You may have came in with a limp leg, but thank God that you got another leg. So if all you can use is that left leg, and throw your hands in the air, you give God the praise. When you know, you give it back to Him. Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight. We thank you for everything that's taking place. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the prophetic word, God. We thank you for the teaching to encourage us to know, to continue to know you, God, and not know of you. Now, Father, we ask God, even as you begin to teach us, Lord, we ask God that we will continue to be the salt in the earth. We don't want to lose our flavor, God. We don't want to lose what it is you've given us, God. But help us to spread the news to other people so that they too will get to know you. Father, we ask that you help us and strengthen us on every side, God. Whatever it is you people stand in need of, God, let them know that you are with them. We thank you for the people who's been watching tonight. We pray that their hearts has been touched, God. If there's anybody who don't know you as a Savior, let them commit tonight. Let them commit tonight and accept you, your Son, Jesus Christ, as their Lord and Savior. If there's someone who has not totally committed to you, Lord, let them come back to you and say, Lord, whatever it is that you want me to do in the kingdom, if it's your will, then give me the strength to do it. Father, we pray for your people. We pray again for your people, the sick, the shut-in, the bereaved, the children, the married couples, the single. We pray your word specifically over their lives. And because we know you, God, you said we can come to you. Whatever we ask in your Son's name, it shall be done. So we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Don't forget about Friday night. We have Friday night live service. The doors will open at 6:30. Apostle Feenster from Denver Tabernacle will be here. So we're looking for a high time in the things of the Lord. Invite somebody. And then the following Saturday, we have Unroll at 11. And our good friend and buddy, Sister Jeanette, the only lady, Ray, will be there. So we're excited. She'll be here. So we're excited to hear her, as well as Minister Lakeisha and Sister Minister Sheila Harrison. And of course, I will tag team with the ladies on that evening. So I'm excited for what God is doing in our lives. And the people's lives here. Apostle, y'all have any announcements that y'all want to share? Anything we do
tonight? Yes, this month starting on, I think, the 27th. Throughout the week, I'll be at St. Paul in Lundale.
St. Paul in Lundale?
Yeah, we bought it.
Okay, alright. So we definitely want to try to hang out with y'all.
That's
if possible. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So Apostle B at St. Paul and Wandale, the week of the 27th. All right. Amen. All right. Any other announcements?
And Sunday, we got.
public service.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Well, you still never know. All right. All right. If there's no other announcements, then we're going to conclude for tonight and everything.